So let's speak about the elephant in the room. This is Betty. Everyone say hello to Betty. Betty,
how
they respond. This is fantastic. This is a machine that can keep a human liver alive outside of the body for a day. It's really cutting-edge technology that surgeons are already using in the clinic to assess how well livers are doing before transplanting into another human being. This is our liver intensive care unit, or ICU, in downtown Manhattan. Here are a very talented team of scientists, technologists, and clinicians are modifying how we use those five liver machines to keep livers alive, not just for one day, but 5 days. This is a very different kind of ICU where the patient is an organ. So why are we doing this? Each one of our livers gets injected with a vial of white powder like this. This is an RNA medicine. Not exactly like the COVID RNA vaccines you'll be familiar with. This is more sophisticated. This medicine is programmed not only to change the behavior of any gene that we want, it's also programmed to only go to very specific cells in the liver. You're looking at what is in effect a new way of thinking about liver medicines, where we are reprogramming donor organs that are too old, too diseased to go to the patients who really need them. Why are we doing the liver though? This is a picture of my liver. Not pretty, is it? A healthy liver doesn't look quite so pale or so plump, and that's because I have early stages of liver disease. Now, you can't tell by looking at me, and I feel absolutely fine. And I will keep feeling absolutely fine, I promise, for many, many years, until at some stage my liver may scar so badly that it will fail. And when it fails, my only option will be a liver transplant. Are you ready for a very scary statistic? I'm going to ask everybody in this room to look to the person on your left. Oh, they're so interactive. Oh, they love the audience participation here. And then to your right. Yeah? Your other left. 1 in 3 of you has a liver that looks like mine. And the sad reality is that if you end up on a liver transplant waiting list, there is a good chance that you will die before a healthy enough liver is found for you. Ready for another statistic. 1 in 6 of us in many parts of the world born now can expect to live to be 100. What will these healthy 100-year-olds mostly be dying of? Cancer? Infections? No. The wear and tear of old age and disease. Exactly what's happening with my liver. Hearts, kidneys failing after years of high blood pressure, bones crumbling, joints degrading, breathing becoming difficult after a lifetime of pollution. We call these chronic diseases of aging. In effect, many times, we really just mean that your parts wearing out. And this isn't a problem we've always had to face, right, as a species. In the Middle Ages, lucky was reaching your mid-30s. Now lucky is almost 3 times that. In 30 years' time, 1 in 4 of us are going to be over the age of 60, and I guarantee you, you will be expecting your parts to be living much longer than they ever have. We are beginning to approach what some of us refer to as an aging epidemic, and many of us believe could be as important as global warming. So, what do we do? How do we create a society of healthy 100-year-olds where your 60s are about that second career that you've always wanted and not retiring? What's that real change that we need? You're looking at sibling mice from a lab at Mayo Clinic. They are the same age. The one on the left is showing its real age, whereas the one on the right still looks young and healthy. This young one has been given a treatment that removes unwanted cells that tend to accumulate with age. Think of it as cleaning the rust out of its mousy parts. Incredible results like this are really forcing us to, I think, rethink what medicines mean to us, not just agents for curing disease, but agents for maximizing health span. This is the real change that many are advocating for, but I don't believe this is enough. While I do believe it's very important that we think hard about the kind of medicines we'd like to make, I believe it's equally important that we rethink how we make medicines. And it's that belief that brings me here on a stage, standing next to Betty. Let me explain. Let's say you want to make a therapy. You want to make a medicine that reduces scarring in human livers. Roughly speaking, there are three steps. Step one, this is the ideas phase. This is where we call this hypothesis generation, where you come up with that list of genes that you think could affect scarring and which could be targets for your therapy. How do we do this? Well, traditionally, one method has just been reading a lot of papers, looking at what university scientists play with. We call this the street lamp approach because it's a little like searching for your lost keys only near street lamps because that's where the light is. Thankfully, a lot of scientists have now come together to build incredible databases like the UK Biobank that has the genetic and disease information for 500,000 people. These databases are definitely helping illuminate a lot more, but the sad reality is they don't help us understand a lot about the fundamentals of what our internal organs are doing. There is so much about liver function and dysfunction that we just don't understand. And without this knowledge, it becomes very difficult to make a medicine. Bringing us to step two, which is test your hypotheses and make a medicine. Simple, no? This stage lasts many, many years, often a decade or more. Here's the rub. We, of course, can't experiment in human beings. So we do a lot of work in animals. We poison mice. We actually perform very cruel surgeries on them to make their liver scar, all the while knowing that this is very poorly predictive of what we can expect in human beings. Mice only live for about 2 years, whereas the scarring we're talking about can build up over decades. If I'm to be very honest with you about the mice that I showed you, we have no idea if we'll achieve the same result in longer-lived humans. The reality is we have cured so many diseases in our rodent friends, only to find out that these therapies are effectively useless by the time we reach step three, which is test your therapy in a human being. Here's the problem with clinical trials for chronic diseases of aging. They take very long, are very expensive, and usually fail. You can spend easily $100 million doing this kind of scarring trial only to find out that the mice got it very wrong. Isn't that crazy? No wonder it is so difficult to make the kind of transformative medicines that we need so that you can look forward to your 60s. So what do we do then? Well, we solve this by taking on the challenges in those three steps. We don't know enough human biology. We're overly reliant on animal models and clinical trials that are too long, too expensive, and too high risk. This is the challenge the team and I set ourselves when we decided to make medicines in a very different way, and I'd like to walk you through just the first two steps. Step one, learn about how the liver actually works at scale. To do this, we've set up labs in Europe, Asia, and the US, where we are sequencing and studying livers in incredible detail. Here's one example of how we do things. You're looking at an image of a biopsy. This is a biopsy from a single liver, one of 1,000 livers that we studied in the UK. We take that image and we break it up into the smaller images you see there. We then feed those images into an AI algorithm that we call a self-supervised deep neural network. This algorithm can learn without human supervision. And when it does that, it's able to paint an image like this. This image, this abstraction, is how the algorithm is actually making sense of very big, very complex data across very many livers. It's taking all of that and reducing it down to what it sees as simpler core elements. This is very similar to how artists such as Mondrian looked at the world around them and reduced it to simpler core elements. This is Mondrian's depiction of New York City, which has famously been hanging upside down all of these years. It's pretty obvious which way up is, no? Our algorithm does exactly this. It takes very big ideas and reduces it down to something that simpler human minds can collaborate with. And we're doing just that. So for example, that element over there is something that we recognize as fat buildup inside the liver, which I'm showing you here as the light parts in this biopsy. We can also map these elements to every gene. And here I'm showing you the very beautiful spatial expression of one gene in green. We then can map all of these to patient traits. And we've done that for blood, patient histories, and even general features like body weight. In doing this, we're building up very detailed atlases from genes to cells to tissue to organs and then whole patients. But that's not enough. We want to be able to test our hypotheses, step two, in human models. Our lab in Oxford takes a bottom-up approach. And by that, I mean we take lots of different types of cells from different donor livers and we bring them back together to build little models of what we see as liver function and dysfunction. Our lab in Taipei takes a more top-down approach. This is the only lab in the world that has set up a clinical network to receive biopsies from diseased livers, turning each biopsy into about 50 slices and then culturing these slices in the lab as mini diseased microlivers. Using these approaches, we're learning a lot about human biology and making therapies to change the biologies that we see, bringing us to the final stage. That is testing our therapies in whole human livers. Here we look at how we can improve the function in the livers. So in effect, doing the clinical trial before the clinical trial. Here's a really cool thing. So yes, we are repairing livers outside of the body. But remember I said to you that these medicines are programmed to go to certain cells in the liver. That's because once we've learned how to do that, these medicines become a shot in the arm of patients with liver disease going directly to their livers to repair their livers inside their body. Hopefully one day doing away with the need for transplant altogether. Here's another really cool thing. So remember I said that step two, from ideas to step three, clinical trials, that part often takes 10 years or more. Using these kind of approaches, we're able to go from step one to a new therapy to generating human data on a new therapy in days, not years. So sure, I mean, I will agree, these aren't perfect models. No model ever is. But what this is helping us to do is learn to fail fast so that we can be a lot more sure about the therapies we want to take forward to step three. I want to share one more thing that I think is super cool. So we're not just generating a lot of data on genes and cells and livers, we're actually building computational models. Our goal here is that AI avatar human liver models make such good predictions that they start helping our scientists come to the right conclusions even quicker. And we're doing just that. So this is actual data from our lab. Here I'm showing you the low success rate you can expect using traditional experimental approaches. So if we randomly take genes, we take 100 genes, 250 genes, and then 500 genes, at most, we can expect to capture about just over 3% of the really interesting genes out there. If we take these experimental results, the data, and feed it back to an algorithm, the algorithm can have a look at what's worked and what hasn't, and then make suggestions about which genes we really want to be looking at. When we do that and go back to the lab, our success immediately jumps up. So in a single step, from humans talking to algorithms, talking back to humans, we've already dramatically increased our success and crucially at a fraction of the price it would have cost us if we just used traditional experimental approaches. What I really like about this kind of story is that in an age where, frankly, I feel there's a lot of hype around AI, what it will do and how it might supplant all of us, we're coming to a more pragmatic conclusion that algorithms and humans actually make for really great collaborators. And it's this lesson that I believe has very deep implications beyond just chronic liver disease to other diseases. So for example, machines exist that not only keep your liver alive, but kidneys, heart, lungs. Imagine when one day This is not a liver ICU, but an organ ICU. Imagine these organ ICUs all over the world where donor organs that aren't transplanted can go. Imagine scientists being able to really form ideas and quickly test out therapies without having to wait for years. The current hope in transplant medicine is that each one of your organs may get to save a life. My hope with this kind of science is that the gift of my organs will get to transform millions of lives. Thank you.